today.
Praise God. Now that word may seem awfully short and awfully small, but it means a lot. How to win the war against the devil. James 4, 7 says, therefore submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. The first step, you have to surrender my life to God. That's the first step. You see, before you ever can expect to win the war against Satan, you must settle the lordship issue. That means two things to two different groups of people. If you're here today and you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, you need to do so. Don't put it off. It's the most important decision that you'll ever do in your whole life. Because none of us can ever enter the world the same way we left it or came into it. First, I'll give you the bad news, then I'll give you the good news. The bad news is we were all born into the world with an enemy who is right there ready and waiting to kill, to steal, and destroy us. Jesus tells us in John 10, isn't that the pits? I mean, here we are, a beautiful, precious, innocent bundle of joy, a little baby. We've never even had a chance to do something to anybody, but yet we already have an enemy. Someone who wants to destroy us from the moment that we're born. The good news is we are also born into the world with a Savior, Jesus Christ, God's only Son. He's the only one, the only champion and victor over the enemy our soul has. His name is Satan. He alone has the power over the evil one. So the only way to be safe is to have Jesus on your side. I'm sure it's hard to imagine that your precious little angel, your bundle of joy, your little baby, has any enemies. But it's true. And it's up to you to stay submitted to God. Resisting the devil in your own life, commanding him and his evil servants to flee from your children. It's your responsible to be protective and cover them until they have the knowledge to understand, to submit their lives to God themselves. But in order to win the war against the devil, we must submit our life to God. You must what? Be born again. But before we move on, I have to mention the lordship a little bit further. We've heard many Christians quote James 4:7, and many times they leave out the most important half of the verse. You heard it again and again. Resist the devil, and he will flee you. Resist the devil, and he will flee. But you see, that's only half true. The only way we have the ability to resist him and the authority to make him flee is when we're living the total life of Christ. In other words, if you're a Christian and you're living in sin, don't think for a minute that you can just quote James 4:7 and the devil will flee. And he's going to run for it. It simply doesn't work that way. You can say, I go to church. I do all the good things. I'm just honky-dory. But I'm going to go out there and drink tonight. I'm going to bring out a bunch of $1 bills and head to the strip club. And I'm going to go there and I'm going to say, flee, devil, flee. You know what? It's not going to work. You have to first submit yourself to God. In other words, you have to accept and say that God has the authority. You have to say that he is the one that's in charge. And then you have to try, you can't say do, try to live his lifestyle that he has commanded for you. And then only then you can say, flee, devil. Because if you're under the submission of God, you won't be going to the strip club with $1 bills. You won't be going to the bar to party. You know what you'll be doing? You'll be trying to do something for him. Maybe you'll be out of that parking lot of the bar sitting there waiting for someone to run off the road, drunk, so you can pray for them. Maybe you'll be out there praying for everyone that walks in the bar. Not saying, going to the bar and saying, don't go in. But you sit off in the corner where they don't see you, and you start praying for every soul that walks in and stumbles out. You see, then you can tell the devil to flee, and he'll flee. If you're starting to think that Satan can actually come into your heart of a man in such a close touch with Jesus as Judas was, and more, he's trying to do it every day. Satan is trying to come into your life, whether you like it or not. It's like trying to drive around in a car full of cash and the doors unlocked in the worst part of town. You're inviting him to come in, but it's your responsibility to put the cash away and lock the doors. How do we do that? We put Jesus as the person that you call up. He's the one, he's that thing that, what's that called when you get in a car crash and iStar or whatever it is, OnStar. Jesus is your OnStar. It's a little quick story. This is true, I'm going to tell you. I was at a state meeting one time, and this pastor had just bought a brand new truck. My wife remembered this. He bought a brand new truck, and he's like, this is cool. God gave me this truck. I always wanted this truck. And he's like, he's feeling the leather seats. He's touching all the dials. He's driving around saying, man, I got the newest truck out here. And he's driving, and he's touching everything. All of a sudden, this voice, and he's praying to God, thanking him at this moment. And his voice comes out and says, may I help you? What do you need? And he looks around, and he's totally shocked. And he says, God, is this you? He says, no, it's not God, this is OnStar. But what I'm trying to say is, God is always there when you ask him to be there, if you're listening and doing what you want. You see, what he wants. You see, in order to have OnStar, to have it work for you, what do you got to do? You got to pay for it. And then you got to install it. Then you got to use it. You can't go and have OnStar in your vehicle, drive your buddy's car that's barely driving, get in an accident, and then yell out the window to OnStar, call the cops. It won't work. Same thing with our life. You have to submit yourself to God in order to have God in your life. Now, God is around everywhere, but just waiting to have you ask. Submit. Being submitted to God simply means Jesus is Lord and I'm not. Jesus is God and I'm not. God is in charge and I'm not. Submitting to God means he is Lord. He is in control of everything in my life. My only responsibility is what? To keep my eyes on him. To love him. To honor and serve him all the days of my life. You see, if you do that, that's called submitting. Let God work his will in you. Yell out, no, yell to the devil and watch him scamper. You see, when God is in your life, you can tell the devil to leave, but there's also a big mistake. Sometimes something's not going right in your life, and you think the devil's doing it. No, the devil isn't doing it. God has put a block in your life to teach you a lesson because you're too hard-headed to listen. You can say, I have no money. I have no job. The devil has done it. But God's saying, listen. If you just submit and do what I ask you, I'm going to give you the job of your life. I remember when I lost my nursing job, me and my wife were sitting in a church. I had just lost my job 3 days prior. And they had this singer come and sing in the church. And he's out there, and the first thing he says, I have a problem. I tell people what their problems are. And if you don't like to complain to God, I can't help it. He tells me, I tell you. And then he started singing. Yes, it was Southern gospel. He's just singing and everything. Me and my wife were in the middle of church, off to the side next to the door. The side that no one ever goes to. Except when you walk into church, that's where the sinner goes in when he doesn't want anyone to see him. He goes near the door so he can get out quick. That's where we were sitting. And he walks right up to me and my wife, and he's singing, and he stops. And he points to me just straight out and says, God took you out of that, so you need to be in a better place. Turn around and pointed at my wife and said, stop worrying about the money, and walked away. He didn't know my wife was crying about the money every day. He didn't know that I had just lost my job. But see, I had to submit to God. There was something that I wasn't doing right. What it was, I had to go to the jail where I was working. That's where I got the job. Because when I went to the jail, there was a man in the cell waiting to speak to me that said, what did I do wrong? Because I had known him in the ministry and I had moved. And I gave some to the ministry, but I didn't follow up. I just thought they would do what they were supposed to. And all he said was, what did I do wrong? I was willing to sweep the streets in front of the church. You see, God sent me there to hear him. It broke me down. It breaks you down when someone says, what did I do wrong? And you're supposed to be professing the word of God. You're the one that's supposed to be saying all these great things. You're supposed to be helping them get jobs and all this. And then you leave them and they ask, what did they do wrong? Not what did you. They're not blaming anybody. They just want to know, what did I do wrong to offend God? I just want to get closer. You see, I had walked out of the submission of God. I was leading my life. God wasn't leading my life. I realize that now. So God, it wasn't Satan doing it. It was God putting it in a way that I would have to listen. Because I was the nurse, I had to listen. There was no way around it. Now, if we're going to go to war against sin and Satan, we got to get serious and quit playing games about Christianity. We're going to win this war against the devil. We got to be serious as Christians. We got to stop pretending we're Christians. We got to stop going into the garage and pretending and saying because we're in a garage, we're a car. There's too many people going into the church and calling themselves Christians because they're inside of a church. There's too many people acting like they're saved because they walked into the church. Let's cut the brass tacks. Let's call it what it is. If you're a Christian, you're a Christian. Do what you're supposed to do. When I was in the Marine Corps, if I wore my uniform and I didn't do what I was supposed to be, I'd be in the brig and then I'd be kicked out. And I was no longer a Marine. To be a Marine, I had to act like a Marine and do things that Marines do. If you're going to be a Christian, follow Christ, make him Lord, and do what he says. It does not matter what you think about it. It does not matter what you want about it. It's only about what he wants. Second step is, you have to resist the devil. Resist him. Peter says, watch out. Stay focused. Stay on the altar. Beware. Be careful of your adversary, the enemy of your soul, the one who Jesus says has come to steal and kill and destroy you. Always be on the prowl. Picture this. Peter says like he's a relentless, hungry, devouring lion who is always on the lookout for prey. So when I want you to close your eyes and get a picture of your mind what Satan is. He just is waiting. He's like the guy outside in the dark who's letting you know it's payday. You see people that are always prepared. The armored car people. Every day they go to the bank, they have to be ready for someone to jump out at them. They can't repeat the same things they do every time because they know someone is watching. Not to get them in trouble, but to steal the money and kill them if they have to. Well, Satan is the same way. He's watching you in here. He's watching you at home. He's watching you when you're asleep. He hears what you think.
It's not a secret.